Hello everyone, my name is Jones and today we are going to talk about integrated management of childhood illness, abbreviated as IMCI. Okay, so this is a program that was rolled out by WHO, especially for resource poor countries to help come up with the diagnosis and improve rationalization of drugs as you are managing children with common illnesses in the region where you are staying. Okay, so our introduction will be like, IMCI is a way of delivering child care services in which the contact with the child brings together all possible ways and means for care of child and mother. So IMCI will be discussed in three parts, which will cover the general information on IMCI, then IMCI process for children aged 2 months to 5 years, and then I also talk briefly about infants aged 0 to 2 months. So IMCI was developed as a way of delivering child care services, okay, and that is with the children, so that you can come up with a diagnosis and manage them well by identifying cardinal signs and symptoms that may show severe illness and also give appropriate treatment. What acronyms IMCI stand for? So the acronyms IMCI stands for I, integrated, referring to bringing together curative, preventive, and development aspect of child care into one strategy, in addition to the proposed management approach. So the I in IMCI is for integrated management. Also, this for integrated. Then M, management. Here it should be seen as having both a clinical, preventive, and a promotion part. Then C, childhood, referring to children under 5 years, the child age group most vulnerable to illness and death. Okay, so that is referring to children under 5 years. And this group is taken to be most vulnerable to illness and death. So IMCI. Then I, the I after C is illness. Here it has been used to address conditions that are first major cause of death, severe illness or disability in under 5 children. So IMCI is a step-by-step process. Okay, so step-by-step management helps to look at the entire sick child so that major signs and symptoms of illness are not overlooked. So when you're talking of IMCI, you are looking at the step-by-step process of looking at the entire sick child so that we do not overlook major signs and symptoms of the illness. So integrated management of childhood illness has 6 modules. That is, if you want to further your studies on IMCI. So there is module 1, which necessarily focuses on assessing and classifying a sick child aged 2 months up to 5 years. Then module 2, this one will take you through identifying the treatment. Okay. Then module 3 mostly covers how to treat the child, or will cover treating the child, the treatments that are there for treating the child. Then mode 4 mostly looks at counseling of the caretaker, the person looking after this child. So it looks at counseling the caretaker. Module 5 mostly looks at management of the sick infants. Then module 6 it takes you through the follow-up, okay, the follow-up visit and what you need to do during the follow-up visit. Okay, so now with this discussed, let's now look at the learning objectives of this lesson. At the end of the presentation, you listeners or followers of this same lesson, you should be able to describe the concept of integrated management of childhood illness, abbreviated as IMCI. You should be able to assess and classify the sick child aged 2 months up to 5 years. You should be able to identify treatment for the child. You should be able to counsel the caretaker on caring for the child's health, growth, and development. And lastly, you should be able to discuss the management of sick youths, sick young infants up to 2 months. Okay, other objectives is to reduce significantly mortality and morbidity that are associated with major cause of disease in children. If you are a practitioner, you know IMCI, you'll be able to reduce significantly the mortality and morbidity. Okay, so that is one of the objectives of IMCI. Then the other reason or objective is to promote improved growth and development of children. Okay, so now with that discussed, let's now define IMCI. So IMCI is a holistic strategic approach to child care that combines a curative, preventive, and developmental care aspect of children under the age of 5 years at home, in the community, or at the health facility. The approach was developed by the United Nations Children's Fund and the World Health Organization in 1995. The age focus for IMCI in children. So treatment guidelines are for children under the age 5 years of age. These are divided into two categories. We have young infant aged up to 2 months. So that is all sick young infants under the age up to 2 months must be examined for signs of possible serious bacterial infection. Then two, children aged 2 months to 5 years. All sick children of 2 months to up to 5 years must be examined for general danger signs. Okay, so now let's look at the advantages of IMCI. So the talking about the advantage, what we would say is that if this focuses on care of child as a whole and not on the reason for the visit. So we are looking at the child as a whole, but not necessarily just the reason for the visit. Then it ensures the early identification of all serious ill children. With IMCI, you will be able to note the danger signs that have been categorized within IMCI, and you'll be able to identify all serious ill children. Then ensures integrated management of all prevalent illness that the child may present. Each and every region may have certain diseases that are prevalent in those areas. So it ensures there's an integrated management of all these prevalent illnesses. Then number four includes the application of preventive measures along with treatment for detected illnesses and health problems. Number five includes action to improve parental practices in caring for the child at home. Number six can be adapted to the local epidemiological situation. Okay, so some of the trainings that to do with IMCI, we have basic integrated management of childhood illness, okay, which is for 12 days, and then there are also training for IMCI follow-up course, which is for 5 days, okay. Then IMCI on the job training, those can still be done so that those that are working can improve their skills in managing children. Then there are also IMCI supervisory skill trainings that are valuable to help practitioners and those in training, okay, to learn more about IMCI. Okay, so follow-up after training is an essential activity in all IMCI training. Okay, trainings that is 1 month after and 3 months after. So that after people are trained, then it is seen that they are practicing what they have been taught and they are practicing the right thing. Okay, so what are the basic job aids and forms in IMCI? This is a very, very important, because as we are practicing, we need to know the job aids, okay, and forms. So we have the IMCI chart booklet, of which when you are learning IMCI, it's important that you have this chart booklet, okay, as a reference. Okay, then IMCI patient's logbook. Okay, then there's the sick child recording forms. So we have one for age 2 months up to 5 years old. Then two we have for sick young infant that is aged 1 week up to 2 months. Then we also have mother's counseling card. Okay, so now let's look at common causes of morbidity. That is, morbidity is to do with illness, and mortality, that is to do with death in under 5 children. So this one, I'm necessarily looking at the region of Sub-Sahara. So the common causes of morbidity in Sub-Sahara and mortality for children under 5 years. So 4 most common causes of ill health and death among the under 5s. Here, mostly in reference to the Sub-Sahara, it depends the area that you are in. But in Sub-Sahara, one is pneumonia, two is diarrhea, three is fever. Okay, so for fever, it can be either because of malaria or measles. Then four is ear infection. Okay, on other causes of morbidity and mortality, we have acute malnutrition, tuberculosis, and 7 HIV. Okay, so it's also important that you note that the sick children may come with a combination of illnesses. Okay, for example, the child may have HIV and then also suffer from acute malnutrition. The child may have HIV and then suffer from tuberculosis. Okay, or may have HIV and then has diarrhea. So they may come with a combination of illnesses. Okay. All right. So now let's look at the essential IMCI drugs at health facility. So what are some of the essential IMCI drugs that you need to have at the health facility? Having discussed the common morbidity and mortality conditions. So, the essential IMCI drug that needs to be available at the center includes oral antibiotics, where you have first line amoxicillin, oral antimalaria, first line amoxicillin, then you have first line artemether-lumefantrine, and second line quinine. Nalidixic acid tablets. Okay, so can also have some tetracycline eye ointment for children suffering having eye problems. Then there's iron, vitamin A, paracetamol, vaccines, mebendazole, albendazole, tetracycline eye ointment, which I've mentioned, gentian violet, vitamin A, chloramphenicol. Okay, so chloramphenicol, optional. Okay, so then we have gentamicin, then benzyl penicillin, okay, which may also be optional. But these are the essential IMCI drugs that you need to have at the health facility. And let me begin to mention that these are some of the drugs that we are going to use in management of children under IMCI. Okay, so they are very, very important that we pick from these drugs. Child with malnutrition may need deworming tablets. A child who's having certain illnesses might have missed vaccines. Okay, so child with eye problems may need vitamin A. Okay, so that is the reason that you should have these essential IMCI drugs at the health facility. Okay, so other essential now equipment that you need to have, equipment that you're going to use. So ensure that every child that comes at your center, okay, for examination that are sick and the likes, that you weigh them. So you need to have a weighing scale. Okay, you need to have a timing service device. Okay, so timing devices, in case you're doing observation and the like, so you need to have those timing devices. Refrigerator with a voltage regulator, of course, that's where we are keeping our vaccines. And then you have sterilizers, because we don't want to use equipment that are contaminated, so we need to have that. You need to have BP apparatus for on observations, and then you should also have a pediatric cuff so that we take our blood pressure nicely, and so that we don't have wrong readings. Okay, so now other things may also include a thermometer, okay, a cold chain supply and immunization supplies, okay, oral rehydration salt supplies, water jar for measuring these ORAs and other things that you may do, measuring, okay. Should also have IV insertion sets for children, because their veins might be smaller in when you need to cannulate. But you can also have sterile water for dilution and doing injection giving, plaster, cotton, swab, tongue depressor. All these can be the essential equipment supplies that you need in IMCI, or in an integrated management of childhood illness. So it's very important you know this equipment as you are working. Okay? So now, let's look at the step-by-step process of IMCI, or let's look at the IMCI management process. Okay, so when you're talking of a process, you're looking at the step-by-step method of doing things. So we are going to look at these methods, IMCI management process. Okay, what are these steps that are involved? Okay, so the IMCI case management process, okay, requires to have knowledge and skills in the following process. You need to know how to assess the under 5 sick child, classify illness according to severity. You need to identify treatment for sick children. You need to treat the child or young infant and or refer that child. You need to counsel the caretaker. So you need to have counseling skills and give follow-up care. Number six. So these are the case this is what is required in the case management of IMCI. Case management requires that you should have the knowledge and the skills in assessment, in classifying the disease, in identifying treatment, okay, and treating the child, and then counseling, and also giving follow-up care. Okay, so I'll try to simplify this as the lesson moves on, so that you see the emphasis in this IMCI case management process. Okay, so the first one is assess and classify the sick child, age 2 months up to 5 years. So you can ensure you record the following: first, the name of the child, age in months, weight, and temperature. Okay, so the steps are involved in IMCI process. So we are saying, now this is a simple version, is to assess, classify, identify, okay, identify and treat, then counsel the caretaker. So we ensure that in the form on the form that we are seeing this child, we have recorded the name and other things that are required. Okay, so the steps that are involved, and now this is a simplified version of these steps. We are just saying it's assess, classify, identify treatment, or we are saying treat, then counsel the caretaker. Okay, so now here the steps is more like act. When you're acting, that is A, assess, C, classify, T, treat. So treat. So when you have to treat, you treat and identify the proper treatment. Okay, so ACT, you can remember these steps in that easy fashion, the acting, ACT from the word like action. Okay, so that are involved in IMCI process, ACT. Then you can now talk about counseling the caretaker as the fourth step. Okay, so step one, assessing the child for danger signs. Assessing the child for danger signs. Here, ask the mother what the child's problems are. Then determine if this is an initial or follow-up visit for this problem. It's very important that you identify the type of visit, whether it is for the first time, that is an initial, or a follow-up, which is like a second time or third time. Okay, so you need to ask the mother what the child's problems are, then determine if this is an initial or follow-up visit. This is very, very important as you are assessing. So in assessment, we are saying you need to ask. So what do you ask the mother about the child's problem and whether they are coming for the first time or a follow-up? Of course, in the cards that they were seeing, information as whether it's the initial or follow-up visit, you can still read and see if at all they came listened to with a similar complaint. So if initial visit, assess the child as follows. A, danger signs. Sick child may present signs and symptoms in various degrees. Therefore, determine whether the child has danger signs. So the these are child not able to drink or breastfeed. So child not able to eat anything. That is a danger sign, as the child is likely to may likely go into hypoglycemia. Okay, and if the child is having hypoglycemia, may even go into hypothermia because there is no energy and heat being produced. So child may go into hypoglycemia. Child not able to drink or breastfeed. Number two, child vomits everything. If a child is vomiting everything, it's likely to go into metabolic acidosis, okay? Because the fluids that are coming out of the body. So apart from that, the child is likely to be dehydrated. If the child is vomiting everything, it's also likely to go into hypoglycemia because there's no food which is being retained. So number one is not able to drink or breastfeed. Number two is child vomits everything. Then number three, child has or have had a convulsion. Okay, so convulsion becomes a danger sign. Okay, so it becomes a danger sign because that is a sign that there is involvement of the brain. Okay, there's involvement of the brain, and we don't want involvement of the brain, as the condition may easily become critical and the child may become unconscious. So apart from that, when child is convulsing, that also affects oxygenation of tissue. Then number four, if the child looks lethargic or unconscious. Alright, so that is a sign of meningeal involvement. So if the child looks lethargic or unconscious, that is a sign. Okay, that is a sign of involvement. So what we are saying is the danger signs that you need to determine are if the child is able to eat. Okay, if the child vomits everything, or child has or have a hard convulsion. Then the fourth one, if the child is lethargic or unconscious. All right. So assess for general danger sign if the child has had convulsion. So these are the danger signs in assessing. Okay, so what do we do in assessment? What do we do in assessment? So in assessment, we ask, look, and feel. Okay? In assessment, we ask, look, and feel. Okay? So in assessment, we are using our sight. Okay, we are asking questions and we also film. So now, in assessment, we always have to make it a priority that you assess or check for danger signs. So if the child has had convulsion, that's a danger sign. So now, in asking, you can also ask if the child is not able to drink or breastfeed. So we are ruling out the danger sign here. If the child is vomiting everything, that is also a danger sign. If the child is vomiting everything. Then looking, you can look if the child is lethargic or unconscious. And then you can also see if the child is having convulsion at the time of investigation. So if the child has had convulsion, the mother will tell you if the child had convulsion previously. But if you, as you are examining, you see the child is convulsing, then you can record that. But otherwise, to do with feeding, you ask if the child is feeding or vomiting everything. And then to do with the level of consciousness, every child that you see at the clinic, don't see them whilst they are sleeping. You need to wake them up, okay? As it will help you determine if they are lethargic or unconscious, okay? Then make sure child with any general danger sign is referred. So after first dose of an appropriate antibiotic and other urgent treatment. So if the child has a danger sign, that child needs to be referred. The only exception here is rehydration of the child according to plan C may resolve danger signs so that referral is no longer needed. For those children that are having diarrhea, after you rehydrate them using plan C, they are likely to resolve and to an extent that you may not need to refer. But please, you have to know that any child with a danger sign is supposed to be referred. Okay. Alright, so now, general danger signs in summary, it's convulsions, not able to drink or breastfeed, vomiting everything, lethargic or unconscious, convulsing. So those are the five general danger signs. Okay. So, whether or not there are danger signs, you can ask the mother and check for four important main symptoms. Okay? Conditions, that is. Whether the child has danger signs, you have to ask the mother at least for these four main important conditions. Okay, so for all children that are coming, please, it's important you ask these four main important symptoms of condition. That is, one, does the child have a cough and or difficulties in breathing? So what we are necessarily saying here is that rule out that the child is not coughing. Okay, so ask, does the child have a cough and or difficulties in breathing? Then number two, does the child have diarrhea? So here, simply number two, we're saying rule out that the child has diarrhea. Then number three, does the child have fever, including malaria, meningitis, and measles? So here, number three, we are saying simply rule out fever in this child. Then number four, does the child have ear infection? So here we are saying simply rule out ear infection. So for any yes answer, that is, ask further questions and then you proceed to look and feel. Okay, so the four main important conditions that have to be ruled out is cough, diarrhea, fever, and ear infection. Okay, then in assessment, next part is checking. Okay, what can you check for? So you can check for the following five things: acute malnutrition and anemia. Okay, so that is nutrition status of a child, weight for age, and anemia. Then you also need to check for immunization status. Okay, then also check for vitamin A supplementation. You can also check for vitamin A supplementation. Then also check for HIV status. And then number five, tuberculosis. Check for history of tuberculosis. Okay, or any contact. So then you can examine for any other conditions like skin conditions and worms. So it's important during assessment that you check for malnutrition, immunization status, and check for vitamin A supplementation, HIV status, and tuberculosis. Okay, step two, classifying the illness. Classify the illness. In classifying the illness, A will say to classify means to make a decision about the severity of the illness. B, the classification of severity are color-coded triad system. Okay? Then C, most children have more than one condition. Hence, each illness is classified according to whether it requires urgent treatment and referral or specific medical treatment and service or simple advice on home management. For each of the child's main symptoms, you select a category or classification that corresponds to the color of severity of the child's illness. Okay, so to classify, we are saying it simply means making decision about the severity of the illness. Okay, so this has been coded in a triage system. Okay, and children may have more than one condition, so each illness has to be classified according. Okay, so it is a coded triad system that is used for classification. So the following are the four, that is, the following are the color codes for severity and management. So we have three color codes. Okay, red indicates very severe and suggests referral. Okay, so if the child has a danger sign, okay, then that indicates very severe illness and suggests for referral. Okay. B, yellow indicates moderate. Okay. Initiating specific treatment. So for yellow, it indicates moderate illness and initiation of specific treatment. Then C, green indicates home treatment with advice to the mother. So the mother can treat the baby at home, okay? And you also give what we say, what we call IEC, information, education, and communication about health concerning the presenting problems. So you can classify each condition plus any other condition, for instance, nutrition status, pneumonia with underweight, or diarrhea with underweight. Okay, so it's important you know the triage and necessarily what happens. So red, refer severe illness. Yellow, moderate illness, initiate specific treatment. Green, go home and give health education. All right, so those are the color codes. So red, severe classification, needs urgent attention, referral or admission in patient care. Yellow is a moderate or mild classification for initiating specific treatment. Then green indicates home treatment with advice to the mother on how to care for a child at home. Okay, as an example, advise mother on how to feed her sick child or giving fluid for diarrhea. Okay, so you can teach the mother about hygiene and other things. So you can classify each condition plus any other condition like nutrition status and pneumonia with underweight and all that. So yes, so these are the color codes, okay, that are used in IMCI. So identify treatment. So after classification all conditions, that is, do the following on identifying treatments. Remember, on the IMCI case process. So identify specific treatment for the child. If a child requires urgent referral, give essential treatment before the patient is referred. So if a child needs treatment at home, develop an integrated treatment plan for the child and give the first dose of drugs in the clinic. If a child should be immunized, give immunization. So this requires knowledge about the immunization schedule, that is, on identifying treatment. Remember, the steps of IMCI is act, then counseling. So act, assess, classify. We have classified already. Okay, then treatment, that is act treatment, that is identify treatment, step 3 in the process. So you can identify specific treatment for the child if you have the knowledge of pharmacology and the knowledge of the essential drugs that we have just given. Then if a child requires urgent referral, you have the knowledge of classification, ready for referral, and then giving essential treatment before the patient is referred. If a child needs a treatment at home, you can give an integrated treatment plan for the child and give the first dose of drugs in the clinic. If the child should be immunized, you can then give the immunization. Then for treating the child, treat means giving appropriate treatment in the clinic, that is intramuscular injection or IV fluids. So step 4 is treating the child there in the treatment of this child, so management of this child. So prescribe drugs or other treatments to be given at home. You can also teach the caretaker on how to carry out the treatment, such as oral antibiotics, antimalarial, TB drugs, inhaled salbutamol, paracetamol, iron and folate. So you can teach the caretaker to treat local infections at home, such as sore throat, eye or ear infections. Okay, so this is what necessary treatment means. Okay, then step 5 in the IMCI management process is counseling of the caretaker. So what can we counsel the caretaker on? So we can counsel on feeding. Use infant feeding counseling skills. Okay. Assess child feeding practice in child less than 2 years. Okay. If classified as having acute, severe, or moderate, or not gaining weight, or has anemia. So you can teach them about balance diet, how to cook for the child. Assess the child's appetite. Assess the breastfeeding practice for child less than 2 years. Positioning and attachment and exclusive breastfeeding in child less than 6 months is also very important. So you can teach breastfeeding techniques to the mother. Okay, the proper positioning, the 10 steps, okay, to successful breastfeeding. You teach the mother, okay, on this one for children that is less than 2 years. So assess the complementary feeding practice with sustained breastfeeding for a child that is aged above 6 months and the like. So what are some of the complementary feeds that they are giving? So you can cancel on feeding recommendation during illness. That if HIV exposed, cancel feeding recommendation for HIV exposed infant as per mother's choice of feeding practice. You can cancel on how to stop breastfeeding, okay, when AFAS is made. Okay, so AFAS is just one of those formulas that are made for children. So feeding recommendations for a child with persistent diarrhea, or cancel giving extra fluid during illness, and cancel on mother's health, breast conditions, HIV status, okay, and the implication of STIs affecting the baby, TB. Also can cancel on family planning, okay, or can also cancel the mother on being protected from tetanus, okay, or you can check the tetanus toxoid status, and also maternal nutrition, which is also very important in ensuring that the mother has healthy babies. Okay, you can give follow-up care. Number six is giving follow-up care. So some sick children need to return to the health worker for follow-up. Follow-up visit is determined by severity and type of problem, such as in 2 days or 14 days. Follow-up visit determines if the child is improving on the drug or other treatment that was prescribed. Some children may not respond to particular antibiotic or antimalarial and may need to try a second drug. Okay, so counseling mother on care for child's health, growth and development. Importance of play and communication to age group, that is 1 to 2 months, 3 to 4 months, 5 to 6 months, okay, then 6 to 9 months, then 9 to 12 months, also 12 months to 12 years. So it's important that you counsel the mother on care for child's health, growth and development, okay, and the importance of play and communication to this age group. So giving up follow care, here we are also talking of children with persistent diarrhea also need follow-up to be sure that the diarrhea has stopped. Then children with fever or eye infection need to be seen if they are not if they are not improved. Then follow-up is especially important for children with the feeding problem, to be sure they are being fed adequately and gaining weight. Okay. So now I would encourage you to now stay to also look at now diseases. Okay, so for now at one, we have just looked at the basics, yeah, requirements within IMCI. Then we'll start looking at each and every diseases. So at this point, if you have listened to the whole lesson, it means now you are ready to start classifying the disease. Okay, you are ready in order to assess the child, classify, you get it, identify treatment, okay, treat the child and counsel the child, because you have learned about the 5 steps of IMCI. Okay, we have learned about the essential drugs that are needed for IMCI. We have also learned about the essential equipment that are supposed to be there, and the essential equipment and the essential drugs that you are supposed to have. So drugs and equipment, we have learned about those. Okay, so it is important as you are revising through this lesson that we have just covered, which is the first part of IMCI, that you understand the information that is found on the under 5 card, okay, and the diseases that are quoted there, okay. So in looking at this lesson, we also identified some of the common morbidities, okay, of children that are under 5 years. So these are very, very important that you note them as you are learning IMCI. It's important you remember the diseases that are managed in IMCI or the common morbidity or the cause of morbidity and mortality in IMCI. Okay, so we mentioned the diseases and we also mentioned the danger signs. Okay, the general danger signs in diseases. So when we start looking at the diseases now, we'll be mentioning the specific danger signs. And when we say pneumonia, we'll mention the specific danger signs that have to do with pneumonia. When we say diarrhea, we'll mention the specific danger signs that are also important in that condition. So thank you very much. Please and ensure you watch our lesson on the specific IMCI management of all the diseases, okay, that are discussed under IMCI.